I got DC in the house, my DC homie. Welcome to Black Cajun Sports Talk, Del Greco Wilson. And today we have one of my good friends in this coaching business joining us, Kevin Brodus. He just completed his first year as the head coach at the Morgan State University in Baltimore, Maryland. How you doing, Kev?
Turn me up a little bit more. Yeah.
I'm good, man. I appreciate you having me on. I feel really a big part of the Philly family now. All you guys have taken me in over the years, man. Just trying to make all this work. I appreciate everything y'all do for me.
Well, first, you know, in this time we in, I have to ask you, how is Belinda and the kids? How's everybody? We all good down there, man?
Everyone's good, man. We just trying to, you know, take it slow, you know, keep it low, walking slow, take it slow. We doing it all, man. Just stand in our lanes, man. How y'all doing up there in Philadelphia, as y'all call it?
I might go out once or twice a week, man, just to buy a soda or something, man. I really don't go out and mess with this too much. You don't have to beat me up with it, man. I see the numbers. I'm like, you know what? I don't care about no odds. If one dude can fall to this thing, I'm not taking no chances, man.
I know that's right. I mean, we in dangerous territory right now. Nobody really knows what's going on.
Exactly. Yeah,
we just going off of what other people's, telling us about this pandemic. And it's just unfortunate. You know, we kind of knew this was coming from what I guess, Barack talked about it, you know, what he had set up for it. But the folks that's in office now, I just don't know. I'm not going to condemn them or nothing, but I just don't know if they know what they're doing or where they're, what direction they're going in with this. So we just kind of hope and pray for the best.
Yep, he's definitely in the deep water, and we watching him learn how to swim, and we all hoping, you know, that he can pull it together. Well, yeah. Look, man, since I got you here, you know we're going to talk hoops. I'm going to just put it on the table from the beginning, man. What y'all doing in D.C.? How come y'all producing so many really elite players in high school programs and AAU programs? D.C., how many people live in D.C., man? Like, it's 8 million in New York, 1.5 in Philly, like 750 in Baltimore. How many in D.C.?
It's millions. I mean, I don't know the correct number, the exact number, but it's a lot. It's similar to, you know, the Philadelphia, in between Philly and New York, somewhere in that neighborhood.
So how come, where are all these good basketball players coming from, man?
You know, what happens is in life, a lot of good, you know, players of all sports migrate from the South. And a lot of them have come up to the North, to D.C., Philly, New York, and I think this goes back to the 1950s, 40s, you know, people moving up here to these areas. And, you know, those genes and those bloodlines from the country, you know, carry, you know, for time and time. So I think we all have, you know, a fair amount of very good athletes. I think Philly has a fair amount. I think New York. I mean, you can go all over the country. But
you're right. But y'all seem to be heavy on the – DeMar Johnson's and the KDs and all that lately, man. Seemed like the elite.
And it started with the Elgin Bellas, the Will Jones, the John Thompsons, and, you know, the Dave Bings and all those guys. Lenny Bias, people forget about. We had the Adrian Dantleys. I mean, it goes from way back to now. We got guys from inner city, the suburbs, all over going to the NBA and the NFL. And, you know, I asked a lot of guys in the NFL, I didn't even know was from D.C. And you just hear about them, and, you know, it's amazing, you know, the product and the athleticism we put out here in D.C. It's a great thing.
And it's good to see, you know, the infrastructure you guys have put together, starting with Team Assault on the AAU side, then, you know, coming through with the Matha and Team Takeover and Paul the Six and Team Durant. And it's just everywhere you look, man, I see these teams playing in different venues. They all loaded. I'm like, where they getting all these kids at?
So, you know, the thing about AAU basketball, and we always talk about the DC Assaults, this, you know, one of the first and best AAU programs. And, you know, we talk about the Damanthas and we talk about Hall of Six, like you said, but people forget inner city basketball all started here with the DCIA public schools. You know, I went to Dunbar. At one point, we was number one in the nation. Dunbar, D.C. You know, Anthony Jones, Sylvester Charles, Stacey Robinson. It's been a lot. You know, Bo Hostin, a lot of guys that come out of DCIA. Gene Smith, you know, Billy Martin. And we can go on and on. The spin.
Didn't Darryl Prue go to Dunbar?
Darryl Prue went to Dunbar. You know your D.C. history. We got a Spingon team that, you know, was one of the best to ever come out this area with Sherman Douglas.
So, mm-hmm.
Yeah, we've had our share of guys from D.C., you know, in the inner city, not just the capital schools. Damantha and them came after. And mm-hmm. they were kind of doing the same time, but the DCIA was a lot more stronger than the capital school league. But now the capital school league, now with the educational component of it, has caught up and went past the DCIA. But they'll catch back up.
All right, well, look. Your career is really, really interesting. And more than just about any coach I know, you've experienced basketball at pretty much every level, man. Let's walk the viewers through your journey. You started off playing as a member of the team in the SWAC. So you went deep south, all the way down to Grambling. Then you transferred north and played in the CIAA at Bowie State. What was the difference between those two college experiences, the time you put in there?
Well, the biggest thing is when I got to Grambling, I was a redshirt freshman. I didn't get a chance to really – I practiced with the team the whole time. Didn't really get a chance to get on the floor. And being that far from home was a challenge in itself. You know, I laugh and I think about going back to that and how kids deal with that today. I remember my dad dropping me off downtown D.C., 7th Street, to catch a Greyhound to go to Grambling. It took me.
Oh, you caught a bus to Louisiana?
3 days. It took me 3 days by myself. It was like, all right, handle your business. Good luck. See you when you get home in the spring. with the Army tanks, you know, and I listen to all the guys brewing them talk about the experience. It brings back memories. I mean, I was young, immature. For me, my future was really good at Bowie, but I probably should have stayed. But I was so young, being like a 16-year-old freshman, first time ever leaving the Washington, D.C. area, getting on the bus, going.
Wait. You wasn't a double reclass with a prep year on top, man? You was 16?
No, 16 years old. I was 16 going into Grambling, Louisiana. I mean, I never forget it, you know. Going down there playing pickup with Carl Malone at whatever school, that Louisiana Tech, I think it was.
Yep, Louisiana Tech.
Those type things. But I got on the bus 3 days, never forget it, with two trunks. No, one or two trunks, I can't remember, of my clothes, all my stuff. And
was it a culture shock that did that Southern culture?
Oh, it was unbelievable. I mean, that's a conversation off the record. Yeah, it was a shock. I seen the most beautiful people I've ever seen in my life down. Personality, looks, everything, you know, just good Southern people. And it was fun. It was an experience, you know. And then, you know, I had a chance to come back home, and that's when it all began. The basketball journey began, you know, going to Bowie, sitting out that first year, you know, 3 years in a row, you know, being on a semi-decent team, you know, to.
Well, talk about that. The CIAA, you played in the CIAA. People who aren't, you know, HBCU alums, who really don't understand, you know, that if you talk about the excitement surrounding the tournaments, CIAA tournament is right there with the Big East tournament, the SEC tournament, Big Ten tournament. In terms of paying customers, it's right there with that. People don't understand. What was it like for you to participate in that tournament?
The CIAA was an experience of a lifetime, you know, being a young kid from the inner city. When I was playing, it was in either Richmond or Norfolk. They split the years I played, and the attendance was a sellout every year.
Mm-hmm.
It was unbelievable competition. And those were the years of Charles Oakley, You know, Kenny Bannister, Ralph Talley is the best player I ever played against in the CIAA, who ended up going to the Lakers, if I remember right.
Yep, Atlantic City boy.
Atlantic City boy, exactly. I mean, to this day, he was one of my toughest covers playing the game of basketball. And I played against some good players, and he was one of the toughest. But that CIAA experience is an experience in itself. I tell you what, that's why I went back to coaching, boy. That's how I started off. You know, it was so much fun. You know, I figured, shoot, when they asked me to come back to help out, I was like, yeah, just go to that CIAA tournament. Exactly. You know, it was fun. It was an experience. I mean, an experience of a lifetime. And they say it's still the same as, you know.
Coming to Baltimore, man. We can slide over if you know. Yeah,
exactly. Coming to Baltimore next spring. That's going to be interesting. It's going to be fun. And, you know, because it's always been down in the South. It's been, you know, Richmond, Norfolk, Winston-Salem, Charlotte of late for the most part.
Had a good run in Charlotte, yeah.
Great run down there. Now it's coming up to Baltimore. It should be a great experience. But I tell you, if you never experienced the CIAA tournament, that's got to be on your to-do list. Got to be on.
So you start your coaching career over at your alma mater at Bowie. Then you transition over to UDC. You played for who? Who was your coach? Who did you coach under at UDC?
Will Jones, the great Will Jones.
Now, he had, at one point, the number one Division II team in the country. I was a young boy. The big Earl Jones?
Earl Jones and Michael Brett.
And Michael Brett.
People talk about those two, but then they had Reese Morgan, you know, Johnny Jones. They had some great players back then.
Now, that's another HBCU, right?
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. It's HBCU up in Washington, D.C. on Connecticut Avenue, in the heart of the city.
And so
he won a national championship.
You start to work in it just about every Division I school in the nation's capital except Howard. You went to American. You did some time at GW. And then finally you made it over to Georgetown, which you just don't like Howard, man. What's going on?
You want a true story, so I started off at Bowie for 2 years. Then I went 4 years at UDC under Will Jones, who I think is one of the best basketball minds ever. Then I left there and went to American University for 4 years. And then I went to GW with Carl Hobbs for 3 years, who's my best friend in the business. And then I left there and went to Georgetown for three. Left Georgetown, went to Binghamton for two. Went back to Georgetown for seven. Then I went to Maryland for two. And now I'm at Morgan. So let me catch you up with Howard. So last spring, with all intents and purposes, that's the job that I was going to. They basically,
okay.
I don't know that. I was, you know, with the president, the AD a couple times. I met with them like three, four times. And it just got so... I don't even know the right word to use that. I looked at it and I weighed it and I said, you know what? For me, Morgan may be a better fit. And talking to two ex-coaches, Todd Bozeman and Kevin Nickelberg, saying, you know, for what you're looking for, we think Morgan is a better fit and a better job for you. And after going through the interview process, I kind of agreed because the AD at Morgan was on staff with me at Binghamton. He was my academic guy at Binghamton. And I said, you know, it's better to go with the known than the unknown. So I had it. I mean, they had a chance to get me and I had a chance, but it just didn't work out. And, you know, I wish all the best for Howard other than when they play us.
So after playing and coaching at all those HBCUs, you make the switch over to American, GW, and Georgetown. These are three of the, you know, elite academic institutions in America. They're both predominantly white. What was that transition like for you in a basketball sense? Like, is it much different?
No, I tell you what, the HBCUs do prepare you for. They prepare you how to work hard because your resources are less than what you have at those schools you mentioned. You know, being at Bowie State and UDC, you didn't have the computers or the scouting services. You just had to grind, get in your car, go around and recruit. Back then, that's what you had to do. you had to grind and get in your car. When some of those other schools had all the, you know, the avenues and the things to do to, so they say, be successful. But being at a HBCU teaches you how to prepare for the higher level. I mean, you don't have all the bells and whistles. Like a kid told me the other day, you know, and we had a discussion about coming to a HBCU. He says, yeah, I know I'm not going to have the charter flights. I'm not going to have the, you know, the stipends and this, that, and the other. I said, but if you want to play basketball, and basketball is your you know, what you don't need all that. All you need is a round ball and a place to, you know, work on your craft, and we have that, you know. And that's the thing that HBCUs can teach you, how to work, how to outwork people, other people.
You shared a story about your interview with Coach Thompson. If you could get a PG version, let the people hear that, man.
So back in 2003, and I'm just speculating on the place. I can't remember if it was Indianapolis or not. You know, every April, March and April, you go to the Final Four. And that spring, John Thompson III had moved on from Princeton to Georgetown. And I was at GW. We had built an unbelievable program with a bunch of Philly guys, too, by the way. Omar Williams, people forget, out of Philly, Ben Franklin. And one of my biggest recruits ever came out of Philly, Maurice Rice.
Rice.
Probably still the
score lord, they call him. Yes, he is.
Leading scorer in the over Wilt Chamberlain.
Yes.
So I'm at GW going to the Final Four, and I get a call from Ronnie Thompson and John. Hey, won't you meet us out for dinner tonight? Blah, blah, blah. You know, okay, fine. Never had no idea what it was about. So we get to, I want to say it was the Ocean there. In Indianapolis, if I remember right, we were sitting there. 5 minutes into dinner, Ronnie and John just pops up and leave. Like, we got to go to the bathroom. And I didn't think nothing of it. Soon as they leave, 5 minutes into sitting there, and not even 5 minutes, Big John says, I don't like you. I don't trust you. You ain't it. You know what I mean. And I'm sitting there like, looking around, like looking for cameras, saying, where's the prank? You know, the pranks back then, you know, what's going on? So as I look around, I don't see anything. He says, you haven't done nothing in this business. I mean, he's going in, like, he went from 0 to 60 in no time.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm sitting there like, now, what is this all about? I don't even know this man like this. So he says, tell me what you've done in this business. And I'm looking at a legend saying, well, you know, I think I've gotten some, you know. He said, you ain't got nothing. Did you get Patrick Ewing? I'm like, damn, where is he going? He said, did you get Sleepy Floyd? Did you get Lonzo? Did you? And I'm like, well, maybe I haven't done anything. So make a long story, we go in, he goes, he's talking. He says, you know, I love my sons, and my sons need people around them to, you know, that they can trust and, you know, have their backs and blah, blah, blah. And I'm still, like, mystified what he's talking about. So a couple minutes later, John and Ronnie walks back in to the table laughing. So I'm looking at them like, what just happened? So we go on to eat. You know, we leave. He said, son, you a good – when we was leaving, he's like, son, you seem like a good young man. I like you. I remember when you was at Dunbar with Jones. And I'm like, this Jekyll and Hyde thing, I'm lost. So then come – fast forward to Monday, I get a call from John, and he said, would you like to come over to Georgetown and work with me? I was like, oh, shit, I'm being interviewed. I have been interviewed. And knowing Big Coach, like, he don't want weak people, around him. And I just sat there and took it. And I said, of course, yeah. And, you know, 3 years later, we're playing in the Final Four. You
know? Wow. When now, that's a heck of a story, man.
It's unbelievable. Sometimes, like I tell young guys, you know, you got to always present yourself in a way that, you know, that you will want people to see you in a good light, because you never know when people are interviewing you or watching you. And at that point, I had no clue what was going on. So.
Well, like you said, a couple years later, 07, y'all made that run all the way to the Final Four. You won the Big East regular and conference tournament, didn't you?
Yeah, a few times. We won that year both in 07. And we won after that a bunch of regular season, I think three or four after that. Mm-hmm. But, you know, yeah, that year we won both. It was an unbelievable ride. Then, I mean, going to that Elite Eight up in Jersey in the Meadowlands, I mean, it was unbelievable.
And so you get the opportunity for the first time to head up your own program. You go to Binghamton.
Yes.
And I think you had a little bumpy start off at Binghamton, right? Your first year was a struggle a little bit.
I'll tell you what happened. So my first year, we started out 1-6. And I remember calling Big John and said, called Lil John and said, Coach, I don't know if this is going to work. No, Big John. It was Big John. Now that I think about it, it was Big John. I said, I don't know if this is going to work, Coach. You think I can come back? He said, boy, shut your mouth. Make that shit work. Grind and you're going to be fine. He said, it took me 3 years to get to 500. I'll never forget that.
And he said, at Georgetown.
At Georgetown. He said, people don't remember how bad it was in the beginning for me. And we during that first year, it was bumpy at times, but we ended up being 14-16.
Which was an increase over the previous year, right?
Oh, yeah. We turned out to be 500. I mean, I don't think before then they won more than 5-6 games. So it ended up being, and they were really happy. And I'm sitting back saying, oh, y'all ain't seen nothing yet. Wait till I get these boys in from Philly.
Next year, 08-09, you really take it by storm. Y'all won, what, about 23 games?
Yeah, 23.
Won a share of the regular season. You beat some Big East teams, Conference USA teams, and MAC teams that year along the way.
Oh yeah, we beat a lot of people on the way. GW, Bonaventure, Rutgers, Tulane. Mm. We did it all, man. We went out to beat Utah Valley State. I mean, we beat them all. And I tell you what, a share that year. I don't know about a share. We won the regular season outright for real, because we beat Vermont twice that year. A lot of people weren't beating Vermont twice, and we did it. We beat them twice, and then we beat the year before champions, UMBC, for the regular season and in the conference tournament. So we had our business.
Your best player that year was my young friend, Mr. Rivera, out of Newman Garrett. He came to my office as a high school senior no fewer than 40, 50 times just trying to get eligible. He worked hard to get eligible. And, we became really close after that. And he struggled with the culture and all that stuff at St. Joe's, and he got out of there. It was so refreshing to turn on that TV and see what y'all were doing. Man, them numbers he put up that year, yo!
It was 20 in the book before the game started. You can mark it down. He had 20 points every game.
Did you know that's what you had when you took it?
No. You know what? And it's crazy we talk about that. So DJ was a add-in basically for me. My whole spring was we got to get a point guard. And we get Tiki Maven. But the main guy that really made our team go was Malik Allen.
Malik Allen.
I tell people all the time, we couldn't have won a championship without Malik. Malik was the glue and everything else around it. And when we got – Malik was like, you got to look at my friend DJ. And I said, okay, bring him up, let him work out, play with the guys, came up. And I was like, well, we'll take him as a walk-on before he came up. He comes up and play with our guys. I'm like, what am I thinking about? We got a scholarship, that kid. Best player all year long. I was
playing that league. Now, they didn't give it to him. I remember it clear as day because I'm following y'all because of DJ and Malik. And I see the all-conference awards and the MVP, and I'm like, was it just that y'all was too good? They just wasn't used to the way you was doing it, man. What was that about? They didn't give the boys the recognition.
It was sad. It was really bad. I mean, he was leading score in the league.
Yes. 13-3 in the league.
13-3. I mean, he didn't even make first team. He should have been player of the year, first year. It was sad how they robbed the whole thing. And, it just shows you when you – in a league like that, a mom-pa league that don't take it serious and do stuff like that, it just hurts your league. If you do the right things by these kids, your league will blow up and be better. And I just think they just had it out for us. They didn't see it coming,
They definitely didn't see it coming, and they resented it. And I remember, you had Mark on your staff, and that's my man. And so I used to talk to him. And I definitely was talking to DJ and them. Now, let me ask you a question. So you naming Maurice Rice, Omar Williams, Malik Alvin, DJ Rivera. What's up, man? Well, you're a DC boy. What's this love affair with Philly guys? What is it about these guys that make them so attractive to you, Coach Brodus?
You left off Mark Edgerson.
Yes. Played, well, he's Delaware. Well,
yeah, but he played went to high school in Philly at Lutheran. Jabril Trawick.
Oh, yeah.
Georgetown.
Yeah, 3 years starter.
I'm gonna go with a name, Tamal Fushan, GW.
Mm-hmm.
You know,
Roman Catholic.
You know, Philly has always been good to me in recruiting. And I love Philly. You know, I think those guys up there are hard nosed, tough, gritty, and a high basketball IQ. That's the thing. And people always give Philly guys a bad rep. I always took the other way. These kids, and the way I like to play, their IQ is really, really good. Like, then we get Dante Scott. I mean, started damn near the whole year for Maryland.
21 games for Turgeon as a freshman.
I mean, these Philly guys know how to win. They know how to grind. That's why I like. They grind me sometimes in games. I mean, I just love the way they do things. So, I'm always going to recruit a Philly guy. And it's funny because those guys, you know, you look at Villanova, you look at Temple, you look at LaSalle, you look at a lot of all those Philly schools have always had a part of history, like good runs in their leagues. LaSalle go to a Sweet 16 with Giannini. Mm-hmm. All those years at Temple with Mark and those guys under Cheney, and now Villanova. I mean, Philadelphia's got some great basketball tradition and great players. You started off the thing talking about DC players. I kind of like Philly players just as much. So I'm halfway in the middle with both. You know, I just think it's a lot of talent in Philly.
Well, you know, I was involved with Dante a little bit, and so
a little bit.
So we was really communicating a lot. Then, were you surprised by what he was able to do for Coach Turgeon this year at all?
I'm not surprised at all. I mean, you know, going and watching how those kids work over at MOTEP and some of the other schools, they are college ready when they get there. Mm-hmm. I mean, they work hard at those places. You guys, your AAU programs, and Howard Hudson and them had their team, you know, Kyle Lowry's team, Lonnie mm-hmm. Lowry. I mean, all this, yeah, there's a lot of them up there that are really good. And they're just as prepared as anybody else. And like you say, this is the thing a lot of times happen with Philly kids. They reclass. So they're older. They're mm-hmm. physically mature. They're mentally more mature. So that's why I wasn't surprised. Dante is a special player because he only knows how to play one way, and that's hard all the time. And that's what will get him over a lot of times in the Big Ten. You know, he may not be the tallest, but he's as aggressive and as hungry as anybody else out there.
His unselfishness kind of worked against him in terms of if you're not really a basketball aficionado and you really don't appreciate what he brings, you know, because effort, you really can't measure. You can see it, but you can't measure it. So another guy might have twice as many points and all that, but Donda only cared about one stat, man. That was the win and the loss.
Yeah.
And he brought that to Maryland. It was really – I got to see them probably 8 or 10 times this year. I'm beyond happy for the kid.
The kid is a special kid, and it was funny because he was kind of different in recruiting. He didn't say a lot. Mm-hmm. You know, he didn't never know which way he was leaning. But I remember the day he told me, he started talking. He says, Coach, you know, let me ask you a few questions. I said, okay, either he's coming – well, he's cutting us today. And his questions were so not like him that made me say, wow, this kid's IQ about basketball is pretty good. And I tell you, those Philly kids like that, you can do only one thing with them, and that's to win. He's a winner. And think about this. He's a freshman. He started 21 games for Maryland. It's the first championship Turgeon has had at Maryland.
Yep.
Did it with a starting freshman power forward. Think mm-hmm. about that. And they won the Big Ten regular season, you know, share of it. And Dante was a very big part of that. Think about it. And you don't have a lot of freshmen doing that other than at Kentucky or Duke. But
yes,
he had still stepped in and played his role and did what he was asked to do, and they won.
All right. So look, after coaching at the D2 level with Bowie and UDC, coaching HBCUs, elite academic institutions, being at high major programs like Georgetown and Maryland, you are once again a head coach back home at a HBCU. You know, I'm a Lincoln guy, so I ain't feeling all that Bowie talk. I let the Morgan thing slide. I kind of like Morgan. You know, I've been down to Morgan more than a few times. But how has the experience been so far? You know, because, you know, I know what y'all have in Maryland. I mean, y'all have everything everybody else has. I can't see being too much space between Maryland and Louisville, Maryland and Kentucky. I mean, Maryland's got the best of everything. Do you feel like you have the resources and institutional support you need to make it to the NCAA tournament, win the MEAC, and make a run at Morgan State?
I do think we have all the resources needed to win in the MEAC. I do. And it's my job to put it together and make it work on the floor. They give me everything we need off the floor. You know, I always say, I remember when a coach in the MEAC asked me this year, is it what you think? Is this league that? I said, it is what we make it. And mm-hmm. I'm a firm believer. Given the opportunity, you just got to make it work. And we're not in competition with Maryland or Georgetown or GW. We're in competition with ourselves. We have to make our situation better in our minds, because it is what it is on the surface. And I think that the president is committed. I know he's committed, him and the athletic director, for us to have success. And they've had success before when Bowles was there, when he first got there. They had
boy, he had some real strong runs.
Yeah, and we're trying to get it back to that level there, back to successful winning the MEAC. And I think we are on course to do it. I mean, this year we won 15 games. We're 15-16, and we won 9 games in the league, 9-7. Last year their total win was 9. Mm-hmm. And I think we got it going in the right direction as we speak right now.
Now, I know I don't think he signed a letter of intent, so we can't get real particular. But I hear there's a rumor you might have got a commitment from a top 100 kid, man. Is that what's going on in Baltimore or Cold Spring?
In actuality, he did sign a letter of intent.
So we can say his name. All right, tell me about this kid.
Nassim is a big-time player. I mean, in his junior year, he committed to Florida State, Leonard Hamilton. And I don't know all the particulars of what happened. He backed out, and then he was being recruited by Georgetown and a bunch of others. And I think what happened was this fall, he didn't play high school basketball.
Okay.
He fell off the radar. A lot of people forgot all about him. And now, when we've been recruiting him, Coach Merritt had been recruiting him all year, I said, Brian, just keep it down. Keep it low. Because, you know, in this, people feed off of other people.
So they see you jump on it. Yes.
Exactly. Then everybody, that's how you, when you wake, they say, waking up that sleeping giant. So when he said he wanted to come, I said, you know, let's just keep it low. Because, you know, normally when you put it out there, you offer someone, they always want to tweet it or, mm-hmm. you know, Instagram it, got an offer my ass kick. Don't do that. Just let it go. And it all became, you know, whole at the end. I mean, this kid's a big-time player.
I watched some of his clips. I see the vision. I see the ball handling.
He was top 50 at one point in the country. And I just think I listened to all the guys in the league. You know, I remember Coach Moten said, why wouldn't black kids, you know, that are top 100 kids go to HBCUs? And it kind of piqued my interest because I know this year Howard had a kid visit.
Josh Christopher. Yep.
No, it was like a top 20 kid.
I think it was Josh Christopher. The kid he talking about going to that NBA.
Okay. Thing. Whoever it was, I can't remember. And that may have been him. You know, and I said, you know what? I don't know if that's a waste of money and waste of time, but we're gonna try some of it. But we're gonna keep it on the low. And that's how we got the young man.
Wow. Well,
and we got more coming. Trust me. We got more coming.
Man, I know. You're roster right now is full of kids from the greater Philadelphia area. You know, you got Stan Roberts from Chester. I actually introduced him to Bowles. That's how he got to Morgan. Lapree McCray Pace, just like DJ Rivera, Lapree came to my office and we got his ass through that clearinghouse. You got Kyson Rawls from Newcastle. His dad is my buddy. You got Taj Malik Campbell from Mastery North. And you got Big P Sorber from Team Final and Trent Catholic, man. Why has Morgan, the university and your program, why has it been such a good landing spot for these kids? They all going to graduate, right? They all on pace?
I think so. And I'm hoping they all graduate. That's the plan. This is the thing. People got to understand. A lot of kids from Philly, a lot of times, don't want to stay in Philly for whatever reasons. But think about this. If you from Philly and you want to go to a college like Morgan, it's only an hour away. You can drive to Morgan from Philly, hour, 15 minutes. And it's not too close and it's not too far from home.
And it's familiar. You got row houses.
Exactly. It's similar. It's very similar. Mm-hmm. You're saying, you know, and this is the thing. And I always tell kids, basketball is round wherever you go. And it's played the same two halves, 20-minute halves. And if you want to get away and get a good education, why not come to Morgan State or any other HBCU? Not just Morgan, any HBCU, because it's still an education, you know.
When you bring them on campus and they see the AKAs and the Deltas and all that stuff, is it still eye-opening? I remember the first time I went on late. I didn't know what that was, Brodus. I did. I ain't had no fraternities in my family, man. Like, who are these girls, man?
It's still live and kicking, live and stepping with David Day. It is really, really a sight, you know. And we hope to get guys on campus so they can see that because it's an hour opener.
Yes, it is, man.
It's an impression, you know. And we got to be careful because we get kids there. Like, we had a freshman group, one of them you name. I won't say his name. He got there and he got turned out. I mean, we didn't even know the kid after the first semester. You know, but he's rounding back in shape, and he'll get it together.
All right. So, look, they getting rid of the year in residency. So kids will now be able to compete immediately upon their first transfer. Do you worry about bringing a kid in? Like your kid you bringing in, and he blows up. And now maybe GW or Georgetown or Maryland, they like, who is this kid? And they can take him and he can play right away. Do you really think that will change the dynamics of how you guys go about your recruiting business?
It'll change the dynamics and it's going to change the game. And, you know, I'm 50-50 on it because, you know, you have to, in time, evolve. You have to change. You have to get better, or the time will pass you by. And we've seen this coming for a while. You know, a lot of people is here now, don't want to deal with it, but it's here, and we have to deal with it. It's going to change. People are going to be recruiting other people's rosters.
Yes,
as simple as that.
And the MEAC all rookie team is going to look real sexy. Yeah, a lot of mid major.
It's going to be the feeding ground of the high majors. Mm-hmm. And do I agree with it? No, but you know what? I've been on the other side, too. I've been more of a high major coach than I have been at this level, and I get it, you know. But, you know, that's when you have to have those relationships with the families and the kids. You know, some will stay, some won't. And we just have to get used to what's in front of us because it's coming. It's going to happen, you know.
Oh, man, I got two young boys that I know pretty good. One was all rookie at St. Peter's. He's going to Oregon.
I'm not surprised.
I got another one that was rookie of the year in the PSAC. That's a Division II league. Right. He just committed to Pepperdine.
Well, I tell you like this, and the thing that's scary, they're going to have all kinds of changes on these rules, the APR and all that, because it's not the kid that's leaving your program that hurts your APR, and that's going to hurt it, but it's the kid that's coming into your program. Mm-hmm. When he comes in and he only plays a year or two, it's going to hurt your program. So the APR has got to be something that's got to be looked at and probably revamped or changed or whatever, you know, because it's a domino effect in this. When once the rule changes, these other things that it's going to affect along the way too. So those are the things I hope they look into while they're doing this rule change as well.
What are your thoughts on likeness and images? Because that's another big one that's coming down the pike. I think in a city like Baltimore, a guy comes along, you know, develops a following on Instagram and Twitter, has a lot of success on the court. We both know how the celebrity works at these black schools. When you're the man on a black campus, you're the man, you know? I think these kids could generate some value. Are you in favor of these kids being able to be compensated for their likenesses? Do you think it's going to have a negative, positive effect on what you have to do in terms of managing your program? How do you think it's going to play out?
I don't have a lot of knowledge on it. I do think these kids should be compensated in some way. Mm-hmm. I don't know all the particulars about the likeness and imaging, but it's coming. I know the NCAA probably don't want it to happen sooner.
Mm-hmm.
It's going to happen, but you know, in these days and times, like someone mentioned the other night on the podcast we were on, you know, change is coming.
Yes,
it's coming, and the NCAA has got to be willing to change too. Is this?
Or they're gonna get steamrolled?
Exactly. Exactly, and they know it. So I have hope that they do the right things by these kids, you know, because you say you're a nonprofit organization, but you're getting billions and billions of dollars, you know. It's almost like, come on, share the wealth. Just like, you know, the state of Maryland just settled with HBCUs in mm-hmm. the state of Maryland of 500 and something million.
Mm-hmm.
I think that's Morgan, UMBS, Coppin, Bowie State, you know, something about 500 million, you know, because of the disparity of how they spread the
funding for all those years. Yeah.
Yeah, for all those years. So, you know, change is coming. As my man sang back in the 60s.
Sam Cooke
is coming. And hopefully it's on the positive side for us African Americans. That's the main thing.
Well, look, you know, we really appreciate you coming on, man. Last question. Guys like Kamal Yard and Howard Hudson, you know, we know you, and I know these guys speak and feel very, very highly about you. You my guy, but I want to give you a minute to talk directly to players, parents, AAU, high school coaches in the greater Philadelphia area that might not really, you know Kevin Brodus on a personal level. Why should they send you, their kids, their best players, to Kevin Brodus at Morgan State?
I'm going to be very short with this. And I can look in the camera and say, you know, I have a family. I have kids. And I have three girls and a boy. And I always look at them as being on the other side and someone else is trying to coach them. And I always say, I will never lie to your kid, whether it's good, bad, and indifferent. Because I don't want no one lying to my kids. What you see is what you get. And I'm going to tell them the truth and be very truthful with them, whether it's good or bad, whether they like it or dislike it. Honesty, integrity, and just a person that's down to earth. You know, what you see is what you get. And I just always say, and I had a chance this year, and people will tell you, when I first went in at Morgan, they told me I should get rid of X, Y, and Z. And I was like, no. I'm going to give that guy a chance. And what happened was, and when I explained it to him later, why is, I said, just think if that's your kid and someone already has a prejudgment about him and they come in and just get rid of him. That could be your kid. I said, let's give him a chance because it could be my kid. Or mm-hmm. your kid. And that's the one thing I live by because everyone needs a chance. Everyone needs a chance, whether it's one chance, two chances, three chances. And one thing I will say, I'll give your kid a chance, and I'll never lie to him.
Well, I know that to be the gospel truth, my brother. We appreciate you here, man. I'm coming down to get my Morgan hoodie and my hat and my golf shirt and all that, man.
I see you wearing Temple. Where's your Maryland stuff? You got all that.
I got I got some of that stuff laying around here somewhere, man. I need that Morgan. I need that bear on my thing, man.
Morgan, there you go. I got you. All right.
Well, look, Kev, I appreciate you, man, and I see you, in a couple nights we be on that other thing we do.
Thursday night.
All right, man.
Thanks for having me, man. Appreciate it. Much success.